30 workhouses built throughout Ireland pre-famine and 33 post-famine, and they're all built by the same architect on the same plan. So throughout the country, if you've ever gone to any of the workhouses, they will be built on the same model. Okay, and the front of this building, it was built for 500 people because there's 3 million people destitute before the famine. And it was built, it was a bit like your social welfare of today, where it would house the poor. You had to give up your land if you came in here. You didn't want to come in here. When you came in here, women went, we'll say right, men left, boys, girls, everybody was separated. So they were. And it was to make it as hard as possible so that you didn't want to come in here. It was called Poor Man's Jail. And you were classed, you were an inmate. So you were. And you were a number, you weren't a person, so you were. Because of the amount of people here during the famine, between 1841 and 1851, by 1851 they built on this extension, where you can see the red brick going around the window. Okay, they built that on, and that's the children's dormitory at the very end. And at the height of the famine, there was over 2,000 in this workhouse for the one, and there's over 400 children of the workhouse. So this first building is this one here, across here. So you had, we'll say, a boys' yard, a girls' yard, and there's the schoolroom at the end, the teacher's room. You had this second building then, which is still there, but it's in a bad state. And then you had a chapel and dining hall, a washroom, kitchen. And then you had a third building, which it says idiot ward for women, but it's not idiots as we would think. It was people with disabilities. Oh, that's right. The way they would describe them. Yeah. And then at the back, there was the fever sheds and the dead house. So that when you were very bad at the height of the famine, they would have moved you out into the fever sheds or the dead house, because I suppose it was to stop the spread of disease as well. But you were, if you were out there, you were out to die. Right. So you were. Okay, the little red dots, they mark the mass famine graves, where people through the generations have said you cannot dig their bodies there. So through the generations, the local people would have known where the bodies were buried. Right. And they were not to build or you weren't to touch. Mm-hmm. But you can imagine people really don't know the numbers that will be buried in this area. From 1992, the Fernie Development Group, the people who run the building, have been renovating this first building here. And just to make it a viable project, they built on. So where you had seen the first building here, it's not, you can see the width of it across here. So it goes across to that first window, you know, the big window there in the middle, above the door. And you can see the different colour of stone at the back. And it was just to make it that they could put offices and different things. And we have a lot of community-based projects working within the building. This building here, if you can imagine, the front building looked exactly like this one before it was renovated. And it shows you the state of disrepair it's in at the moment. And the watchtower up here, which was a ventilation tower as well. At the time, they believed the higher the ceilings, the more ventilation. And the less spread of disease. So that was the reasoning behind that. We hope to change it now. We have a project ongoing at the moment. We want to do an arts theatre and we want to do an education centre, and we hope with the mass burial graves around the back to do like a garden of remembrance, so that we can commemorate the dead without yeah. Just to mark that they're there. Yeah. The gate is locked, but you can see the crosses where they've marked where they believe the bodies, most of the bodies are buried. So the third building round here is gone, and so are the fever sheds and the dead house at the back. They're all gone now at this point. There are several art pieces commissioned just to commemorate
the workhouse and the famine, and especially the girls that would have left here. There was 19 girls left here under the Earl Grey scheme to go to Australia to be wives and servants, and because they didn't want the men returning from Australia. So there was over 4,000 in Ireland sent out to Australia to become wives and servants. So this first piece here, and she's called it Voyage to Australia, is to represent the sea, the journey, because they wouldn't have known how long it was going to take. It took 4 months, and where they were segregated in here, in the workhouse, weren't segregated on the ships, so a lot of the girls would have arrived in Australia pregnant. 19 we don't. We got these from the ship records of the John Knox ship, and you can see that the names Byrne, Fox, Fee, Callahan are all common names within this area. So, and we've had a wee bit of feedback from the relatives of Rose Sherry from Australia, and she had about 9 kids. The most of them had about, we'll say, 8 or 9 kids each. That was the norm when they went out. This piece was done on calico, which is a cheap form of cotton, and it's called The Last Resort. And you can see where it's embroidered here, and it represents the family units going into the workhouse, and the door of the workhouse, and the devastation that they must have felt, and the different, we'll say, whether it was a child going in, a mother and child, or whatever. And behind there, the faded figures, they represent the ghosts of the past, the people who would have died. And the artist wanted to also to say at the time that there was a lot of wealth, so she's little swirls that represent the wealth that was in that was here as well, among all this devastation. These are called the forgotten, and if they represent the children, all the children who would have been here during the height of the famine. And at one stage, I think there was about 400 children in the building. And this is kind of their little uniform that they would have worn. And the education would have been very poor, and they would have been, you know, very sickly children, you know, because the food they would have fed them would have been like a gruel, and it would have been just enough to survive. Yes. No more, just enough to keep them alive, so it was.
So are these real, or are these just made up costumes?
These are just, they're called a soft sculpture. Mm-hmm. They are, because I've never just felt them, but there is a little creche in here, and the children have named them. And this is Caitlin, and this is Oisin.
Okay.
And they come out down in the morning, they wave to them, because they feel that they're... Their children, they don't
seem
that they've no
health,
they just
say. Mm-hmm. Some of our investigations that we would do, we would dress up in like period style of clothing.
Right.
So if the young spirit children here, obviously they're going to be drawn to this type of clothing that they would have worn in their time. Mm-hmm. So it's a possibility that this could be like a magnet to them.
Oh, well, I never thought of it like that, but mm-hmm. they do. So that's what I'm saying, they've named them.
Yeah.
We'll go upstairs to the dormitory. We believe that this is the girls' dormitory. And they would have slept on raised boards. And if you look up, you can see the high ceilings and the ventilation on both sides. Again, this belief that it would eliminate disease. Yes. And you can also see at the bottom along the boards, so there's also ventilation. And there's also a little slope on the board, because when they would have slept at night, and if they had... if there was they had urinated, then it would go out the vents. And again, you can imagine there was no heat, and they would have slept head to head, and they would have slept on straw and potato-like sacks. The artist, again, she did a portrait to commemorate what the girls probably would have looked like. And the little names are the 19 names of the girls that left this workhouse to go to Australia that we know of, and the crosses are the ones that we don't know. And when they left, they were given a box
like this here, and it was to be a specific length and width, and they had a list of what was to go into it, and that was all over the country. So they would have had a different, everything that's in the box here is on that list. They would have night wrappers, petticoats, linen collars. So they got very good clothes, because the idea was that they were going out to be presented and that they had to look good. So they
so
would
these
have.
These were given to them?
These were given to each girl. Mm-hmm. And they were that. We have a very good carpenter, so he recreated the boxes. They were a specific size, and their name had to be put on it, and a lock and a rope. And they were given very good clothes. So if you can imagine, if you're coming from a poor house, you thought you were going off to a better life. And some of the parents were still alive, maybe a mother or a father, and they still allowed their children to mm-hmm. go. You can see Agnes Fox was only age 14, mm-hmm. Which was very young. So you can imagine putting a 14-year-old on a ship to Australia for four months. And they also, what would have happened too, is they would have only got up every 2 days for air. So you can imagine how horrible it would have been.
Did you say second, Emily?
Yeah.
No, just...
Neglect. And those factories in here, and, you know, so...
That's right.
Got a set of figure on the lamp there.
Really?
Yeah.
Hello? WR. When you say figure, was it, what height was it? Height of a child. Okay. It's interesting.
No, but I don't think like that, I have to say. I don't believe, you know, you have to fear the dead. And I've worked here late at night, and I've never...
Have you seen or...
have you seen anything in the corner of your eye, or to think, oh, that's different?
Sometimes you get a shiver down your back, but that's as much I couldn't say. I have, yeah.
Yeah.
But that could be my personality.
So, Andy, what have you learned about the history on Carrickmacross Workhouse?
Well, James, Carrickmacross Workhouse was built in 1841. It was one of 130 workhouses that were built in Ireland between the years of 1841 and 1843. It was built to house 500 inmates, as they were referred to, but when the potato blight struck, it actually housed up to 2,000 men, women and children.
So what other information have we got concerning families in this building?
Well, any families that came to the workhouse had to apply for the possession of the workhouse. They then had to surrender all their land and any of their worldly possessions. Once they arrived at the workhouse, families were segregated, and believe it or not, they weren't allowed to see each other unless they had permission from the hierarchy in the actual workhouse.
Mm-hmm. So what about the immigration and the death?
Especially due to the potato famine, actually resulted in a massive reduction in the population of the whole country. Believe it or not, approximately 1.5 million people lost their lives due to just starvation and illness. 4 million people, usually young girls and fit and healthy people, emigrated to places like Australia and America to be slaves for people with money. So with the immigration, it actually left all the fit people were gone from Ireland, and anybody that was left in the likes of this workhouse were either sick or elderly, and that resulted in a very high death rate. One of the cemeteries linked to this workhouse actually has 1,300 plots where people have died from this workhouse.
Alright, we're going to start off in the children's dormitory, the first vigil. We're going to split up into four teams because this place is absolutely huge. On the technical side of the investigation in this large room is where the dormitory where the children would stay. We have it completely rigged from top to bottom. So if you can follow me, what I'm going to show you here is some of the equipment that we have on full display. Down here, we'll have the tri-field meter. Okay. And over, further over, we have the ramp hood, the ETMF. If anything comes close by, it'll just set off the trigger and it'll set off the alarm. And over here, we have our new London meter. What this is, it reads ENF, but it also reads temperature. But the extra piece of technical side of this is it has a static detection device for this antenna. Works similar to the EMF. Again, if it picks up static, which is something that spirits are supposed to give off, it'll set this off. Then over this way here, we're going to run an experiment that we've been running for a couple of years. It's called a vibration experiment. So when we're doing this vigil, we're going to let it run for 5 minutes. We're going to have each team member hold hands, but instead of standing inside the circle, they're going to be standing outside the circle. The reason is you have a better scope of what's going on outside the circle instead of everybody looking inside it. And over here, we have the millimeter. This millimeter isn't your normal millimeter. It's a built-in shadow detection device. And basically what that is, if you can hear it, we'll have a pod. If you can point the camera over that way, you'll see there's a pod at the end. Anything that walks between the pod and the millimeter will trigger it off and it'll set off the alarm. And then also we've got a camera, locked off camera here, down this way. And then we have the vibration experiment over to the right. So we're going to do this, we're going to let it run for 5 minutes, then we're going to get each team member to call out, and we're going to see, do we have any change of the environment? Well, today actually we were up here, and some of you guys didn't know this, but we were up here earlier, and Warren, you said you thought you'd seen something outside, didn't you?
Yeah, it was we were standing here talking with the lady, Margaret, and just out of the corner of my eye, a figure ran right across in front of the left outside the door.
Okay, is there any children in the room? Did I see a child walking in the bottom of the room? If that was you, don't worry. Don't won't do you any harm. Come play with us. Come play a wee game. Want to play a game? Go you dance around us. Dance around the room. Go towards the wee pretty lights. There's red lights and there's blue lights and there's green lights. Thank you for that. Thank you. Good. Good. Thank you. Thank you so much. Now can you make that go like that all the time?
That's brilliant.
Was that you I seen a wee while ago? I seen it at the bottom of the room. Go in front of it, make it. Thank you, sweetheart. Thank you. That's a pretty song. You're making it too. Thank you. Thank you. Is it a boy in the room with us? Is it a little boy? Or a little girl? So it's a little boy. Mom, make the wee thing on the floor sing a wee song again for me. Thank you. So it's a little boy. Thank you, sweetheart. Really lovely to meet you. Really lovely to meet you.
Brilliant.
Thank you too. Thank you. We had this one where we
had this in Down Patrick. We've had the thing. Do you like us being here? Make it sing again if you like us being here with you. Aww. We like being here with you.
There's an elevator on the floor, and this guy explained at the start of the night, it's singing away here. I was calling out for a little boy, or did I see a little boy down the bottom of the room? And I think he likes it too much, I think he's playing with it now. Mm-hmm. I was asking questions, he was answering back.
It's such a lovely wee boy.
That paw that you're looking at, that is attached to the millimeter, and it sits like a directional beam to it. So anything that works within the beam and the millimeter, the shadow detection device triggers it off, and that's what you're hearing.
Yes, I know you can see it. Are you able to go down and touch it, make it light up? I know you love
James,
this.
James, did you make a funny noise there?
I'm boiling.
Did you make it like a...
I heard that too.
Did you not make a...
No, I just turned around and I'm boiling.
No.
I'm boiling.
But you didn't go...
No.
I definitely... Who else heard that, guys?
I heard that.
The camera will have picked that up because I heard what sounded like a...
And touch it, make it light up.
If there's any spirits of little children with us here now, can you please cross the rods as an indication of yes? Is your remains buried in the grounds at the back of this building?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, now I just get a horrible feeling about this one. Were you murdered? Was it you that was squeezing my throat to show how you passed away?
Hi.
Are you standing beside Joanne? Does she remind you of your mother? Are you trying to hold Joanne's hand?
That's okay, you can hold my hand. Give me a big hug if you want.
Put your arms around Joanne, can you do that?
Seriously, it's bigger than the waist one.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Excellent. I'm getting goosebumps right up my body. So, thank you very much.
Can you get back to Joe? This is Joe. My name's Jared. This is Andy Cotton.
This is Andy.
And this is Vlaslav Warren. If you're with us now, could we ask you to stand towards the electronic device that's creating the spark and not slow it down? And by doing that, let us know you're here, Jared.
What happened? Here, listen.
Uh-huh.
The rampart's gone off. Okay, what the hell? Get a night vision. Oh, look at that. Look at that door. Lights up the whole corridor. That's pretty amazing.
I saw something smooth again.
See there?
Yeah, down there. Mm-hmm.
Warren, it wasn't Karen or James, was it? Or Adrian?
No, it was right here.
Here? You sure it wasn't Karen?
No, Karen's up the far end.
Yeah. Somebody just went. Me and John's had a
time. Is anybody with us now? See, it always happens when you do the vibration experiment. I just feel a wee bit on edge, I'll be honest with you.
I'll be honest with you, I don't feel anything.
I feel a wee bit on edge.
No.
I took a pain in my right hand, I don't know what the hell was going on.
I seen you, for instance.
Yeah.
That's when you were shaking that out, that's when I saw
all
the...
Was it? That's when we noticed the REM pod going off.
Yeah. Did you hear it again? No, I didn't hear it. Is it the same one, same thing? No, it was like...
Where did you hear it?
I'll go back.
Up there somewhere.
Just be careful, Warren.
Like we were shaking that out, that's when I saw all the...
Was it? That's when we noticed the REM pod going off?
Yeah.
I can't believe I
did. Take my hand.
What was that? Is anybody with us? Could we ask you to come forward towards us, please? Towards these lights, these red lights? Come on, I know you can do it. Show a wee spirit of light, a wee ball of energy, and that'll be you. Don't be afraid.
Shall I come over and make yourself known to us? I just want to communicate with you. We don't mean you any harm. We're here in total respect and love for you. When you look around, you can see there's a teddy bear. There's also some other things on the floor. Can you go over and touch any of them? Make a noise in one of the corners of the room.
We're just sitting here having a cup of tea and there was a massive progressive crash next door. Everybody just look at each other.
Yeah. When we went in, there was nothing moved.
Absolutely not.
That was amazing.
It sounded as if half the kitchen was coming in the room.
What do you think, Joe? That was impressive, wasn't it?
Really?
That was fantastic.
And there's nobody there.
Just sitting here and crash.
Is that you making a noise over here to my right? Can you do it again, only louder? Come on, we know you can do it. You've done it earlier on, we all heard you. When nothing was on.
You almost think they knew you were playing with us because they knew that nothing. Somebody
walked past the window there.
That's the first time that I've ever seen that.
Was it in your peripheral visions?
No.
No, you actually
I just looked out and I seen a shadow, something dark walk past that window. That was freaky.
Can you tell me how many people are in this room?
Eight.
Thank you very much. How many adults are in this room?
Retards.
Retards.
Thank you.
It's me and Gary on the bottom floor. There's no one else around and we're going to do a fence box set.
Andy, did you hear that? That was clear, that said Andy.
It was a very computerised voice.
It was more a very calm voice, Andy. The door behind you.
That's closed. Tight.
It sounded like somebody at the door. Did you not hear that? I heard it. Hello? Was that you knocking the door? Can you do it again, please? We heard you. I mean, they're the lady who worked here today, she says that the only thing that's ever happened to her was she feels that the hairs go up in the back of her neck. And that's a thing called fright or flight. It's where your body mechanism is actually telling you there's something going on that your mind doesn't assume or understand. It's the spirits that's coming close, that's drawn the energy field in around to create this type of phenomena, possibility. Did you hear that?
I'm not you moving the table when you moved
it. No, that was a window. That was like a tap on the window. Possibility. Did you hear that? That was like a tap on the window.
I put that down to the table.
Yeah.
I thought the table was up against the windowsill.
Mm-hmm.
Now I know there's a good 40 centimetres of a gap, so there's no way the table could have hit
them. No. And you heard it then? You definitely
yeah.
heard it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, that's good.
Come on.
Forward to the open door.
What is that?
Come over to the door. Make the noises louder if you can. Use our energy around the table.
It's almost like we stopped.
Shake her up.
It's been so Throw a hairbrush.
Yes.
And your hair, you know.
It really has.
And
it's more already blonde, is
it? Your face has changed.
Here's
one.
Here's
one. Yes.
Oops.
Is it got better looking?
So it has.
And your hair.
Joanne and I, we were out at the Mass gravesite store, and we were walking down towards a gate at the back of the building, and under me, Joanne was about five steps behind me, but there was a figure walking there beside me, which I thought was Joanne. I turned around, there was something there, and then it disappeared. I turned further around, and Joanne was further on there behind me.
We were outside. Adrian and I went down to the cemetery. As soon as we got through the gates, the K2 meter went off, went right up the green, wasn't it, Adrian? And the thing is, there wasn't any electric near us, so there was nothing could interfere with it. We came back out and it stopped again.
At the beginning of the night, whenever we joined Warren and Joanne initially to help them with table tipping, but then the REM pod started to go off. And Gary, you said you felt something in your right hand. Joanne and I heard somebody like gagging or something. We heard like a sound, and then when you were shaking your hand trying to get the pain away, I saw a shadow, like a white misty something cross the corridor.
Actually listening to Karen call out and hearing the shadow detector go off, and also whenever me and Warren were up there as well, we heard the other staircase, we heard like a noise out on it, and I hadn't realised that that was a staircase at that point. And Warren had just said a few minutes before about something happening on the staircase, and then that happened.
Three seeing shadows, part apparition of a little boy, the shoulders and the head, for a slight second, and it was gone in the conference room, to the shadows in the hall, and hearing a voice behind me going, like that, right behind me, and it actually did scare me. To the shadow detector going off up in the dorms and outside getting stones thrown, and it's just been a very active night.
And we're all sitting in the kitchen and just chilling out, having a cup of tea, and a merciful progressive crash next door in the room we're actually sitting in now. It didn't just happen all at once, it was a progressive crash. And we all heard it, we all rushed in, and there wasn't a thing out of place, and we couldn't replicate it at all. Gary actually came in here, and we went back into the kitchen again, and he tried to replicate it, and there was nothing that we could get to make the same sort of noise again. Yeah, it was really strange.
Seeing the two shadow people, the child and the bare feet running across the room, and being out at the graveyard, and wee stones being thrown at us. I thought that was amazing.
Because each team member had their own experiences. Was a couple of things that stood out for me were me and Andy was doing the Frank's Bar session down in the one of the small rooms down the bottom floor. And I specifically heard like a tap on the window. My Andy thought originally that I'd moved the table and it was beside the window, but there was a gap there, so we can't explain that. And also when we were down in the conference room, it's the first time that I have ever seen it full on. I definitely 100% seen a shadow, thinking it was one of the team members. So I got up, and Andy will back me up here. I run out thinking it was one of the gang had walked past the door.
But in the hall, did you see
Yes.
that?
And not only did I see it, but other team members have seen this shadow as well. So all in all, we've had a discussion and we're at an agreement that we do believe that there is a haunting at Carrickmacross Workhouse.
Neglect and those factories in here, and you know.
Double R. You say figure, was it, what height was it? Height of a child.
Just saying something. That's around the room. Go towards the wee pretty lights. There's red lights and there's blue lights and there's green lights. Thank you for that. Thank you. Good.
I know you love James, did you make a funny noise there?
I'm boiling.
Did you make it like a...
No.
Were you murdered? Sean.
Hey, sir.
What? What happened? Here, listen. Listen. The rampart's gone off.
Can you tell me how many people are in this room?
Eight.
Andy, did you hear that? That was clear. That said, Andy, possibility. Did you hear that?
Did nobody hear that? Oh,
cheese
grater.
Did you hear that?
Did you hear
that?
Yeah,
was
it? Yeah. Your face has changed.
Yours.
What one?
Yes.
Is it got better looking?
So it has.
And your hair? No.